位亲爱的来宾，大家好。物理大师演讲《崭新光明大道》现在正式开始。首先，谨请本次活动的主办单位国立台湾大学校长杨盼池校长为我们致辞。欢迎杨校长。
Professor Matsumura, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, it's really my greatest pleasure and honor as the president of NTU to host the Nobel Laureate special lecture by Professor Nakamura. As you know that Professor Nakamura, because of his great contribution in the blue-green LED, actually revolutionized the energy-efficient lighting. The invention has also made great contribution to the mankind. It's not only in the lighting, but also in medicine, in display, and in optical storage. Because of his greater contribution, so he has been awarded 2014 Nobel Prize. I'm sure today's lecture will be very inspiring. Actually, we are just talking about the Henry Young. Professor Nakamura actually now is in Santa Barbara. Henry Young is Yang Zuyo, 校长是我们的校友。We graduated from the same senior high school. And actually, he told me a very good story of how he recruited Nakamura before he got the Nobel Prize. But then Nakamura to talk about the story. So welcome. Thank you very much for coming.
谢谢杨校长。先向各位介绍今天的贵宾，第一位是台达集团创办人暨荣誉董事长，暨台达电子文教基金会创办人暨董事长郑崇华先生。第二位是台达电子董事长海英俊先生。第三位是金源光电总经理周明俊先生。第四位是龙达电子董事长苏丰正先生。第五位是亿光电子董事长特助叶丁伟博士。我们现在有请台达电文教基金会郑崇华董事长致辞，欢迎郑董事长。
这个 may I speak in Mandarin 啊，这个中村教授，还有台大的杨校长，还有陈副校长，金融光电的周总经理，跟各位企业界的先进们，各位老师，各位同学，还有各位关心节能科技的朋友，大家好。这个今天真的是非常高兴啊，有这个机会呢，跟这个中村修二教授在演讲前跟各位分享一些想法。那中村教授啊，对于自己信念的坚持，还有无疑的是一个研究者可以学习的一个榜样。那他不会轻易的受别人的影响来妥协，认为对这个事情这个义无反顾的全心的投入，这种精神呢，我在有些工程师上面也看过。不过呢，我觉得要让这个工程师们能够很努力的去做，这个管理者对他的支持，还有呢了解他会更努力，才能够做出一些结果出来。我想对这个中村先生这种成就，对整个能节能上面真的是无限的贡献。这个此外呢，这个中村修二教授对教育的想法，特别是他谈到日本大学入学考试了，抹杀掉很多日本年轻人的开创性的这种想法，这点我想我们台湾也许有些学校 也有类似的问题。如果尤其是我记得我年轻的时候，那些老师好像都蛮好的老师，可是现在我跟小朋友们谈呢，从小学开始，这个他们就要求标准答案，要做的跟书本所写的东西一模一样，我觉得这个就很难理解。那今天的话呢，这个问题的确是很严重，所以我们觉得说，如何去慢慢让老师们能够有所改变。那我自己虽然学的东西，学校我只是大学毕业，那我是觉得我能够做一些事情跟这个老师很有关系。我碰到中学的时候，我就碰到很好的老师，他鼓励你，因为我当年我是认为在大陆的时候，这个跳班啊，这个小学没有好好念，那自己以为科技非我所长，可是看了台中一中的好老师的鼓励，那整个就改变了。我觉得这个天地很有意思。然后到成大呢，赖在德老师，这个给我的启发非常大。他这个讲化学是用物理的原理，这个原子构造来讲，我就听得津津有味。所以这些我是希望能够让今天的学校教育也能够达到这一点。那我总讲觉得说 MOOC 的这种翻转式的教育，只要你很肯学，你可以到网上去，然后请最好的老师把它录起来呢，你可以 interactive， 可以你没听懂你还可以回来再看，然后你到学校去上课的时候呢，可以跟同学讨论或者老师来讨论。这样子我是觉得有了现在科技的进步啊，这方面教育上面可以应用在教育方面是一个很大的改革。我想我就不多讲了，这个 congratulations， you really do something to our earth， it's very helpful to the world， to all the human being， thank you， thank you very much， 谢谢各位，
谢谢。谢谢郑董事长，现在有请金源光电周明俊总经理致辞。
Professor Nakamura, President Yang, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. I think it is my privilege, you know, and pleasure to be here to attend this very, very special event. Actually, I'm also the alumnus of National Taiwan University. I'm very proud of this great university.So since I'm here, I would like to share two stories with you gentlemen and ladies. The first story I think Professor Nakamura will mention about in his lecture. I think back in year 2080-90s, when the research and scientists trying to find so-called the holy grail of semiconductor, which is the blue light emitting devices. At that time,many, many companies, including the big company like 3M, Sony, they all bet on zinc selenide, which is so-called 2-6 material. If I can recall your memory, your so-called high school science in your chemistry, you remember the periodical table? To make a semiconductor, you can either use the group 4, which is the silicon or germanium,You can either use the 3-5 semiconductor or 2-6 semiconductor. At that time, 2-6 is considered to be the only material that can make a so-called shorter wavelength, that is the blue, either LED or laser. However, Nakamura-san believed if he pursued the same path as the rest of the group, he can only beThe best can be the same as the other group. That's why he decided to go for the territory that no one has done before, that is trying to use gallium nitride or indium gallium nitride as the material to fabricate blue LED or blue laser. I think here we have many, many students, you know, and you are the top you know, student in this country. I want to encourage all of you to follow the spirit of Nakamura-san. Do your best. Bet on the things that no one has done before and try 120% of your effort to make it happen. I think this is the spirit of, you know, why we should, you know, try to learn from Nakamura-san. Not just because he won the Nobel Prize. I think his contribution, everybody knows very well. But I just want to share this story with you and let you know that the importance of trying to be yourself, trying to do your best, and bet on the things that you believe. And nobody has done it before. So this is the one story I want to share with you. The second story I want to share with you, I think maybe recently, maybe a lot of you may not be very aware of this, but you know, LED lighting has become a reality in recent years. Especially this year, Philips Lighting, one of the leading company, the global leading lighting company, they actually cut the LED lamp light bulb price to two lamps for $5, meaning one LED light bulb now costs you only $2.5, which is about 75 NT. What does it mean? Actually, this means that the LED light bulb is actually even cheaper than the compact fluorescence lamp that we are using currently. And this is really a revolutionary, you know, so-called a revolutionary move. Unfortunately, for LED lighting company or LED manufacturing company like Epistar, we suffer our gross margin. Because of this, you know, we cannot make any money anymore because of the LED price is now getting so low. So for us, maybe Lexstar is suffering the same thing. Everlight is suffering the same thing. But if you look at it from the brighter side, at least we are contributing to the society, just like, you know, Mr. Zhen just said. We, as a part of the, you know, global citizen, what we can do is we should try to contribute to the world in doing so-called carbon reduction and saving energy. Many of you may know that actually 20% of the energy go to lighting. So if, you know, that's globally, you know, every out of 100, 20% of the global energy consumption actually goes to lighting. So if we can try to save the so-called energy conservation, we are doing our part, you know, for the next generation and the generation to come. So I think it's very important, you know, just I just want to, you know, use these two stories to share with you. And not to mention about, you know, the contribution of Professor Nakamura. He's the pioneer of white LED. And us, together, we follow his footsteps. We, together, we try to make a better world for the future. With that, I thank you very much, and I hope you all enjoy the event in this afternoon. Thank you very much.
谢谢周总。现在有请龙达电子董事长苏丰正董事长致辞。
Nakamura-san, welcome to Taiwan, and please allow me to speak to the audience in Chinese. Yeah. 校长，副校长，还有这个，我也看到我们那个以前的这个李校长也在座哈，在这边我要先自首一下，我今天是翘课，我是翘台大的课来听讲。那我现在在上那 EMBA 班，他给我警告说，你要是有四堂没来上，就给我死档哈。所以我今天是冒着危险来的。不过我在这边呢，应该要跟各位这个 share 几个那个诺贝尔奖他们的特色。当然，这个大概是我比较幸运，我大概在这一辈子里头，大概有跟四五位这个诺贝尔奖得主聊过天。然后这聊天的过程里头呢，实际上就像刚刚那个周总所讲。他们都有一个特质，他是什么特质呢？他就是常常会不承认学校教你物理的东西，就你要先承认说学校教你物理的东西呢，没办法 cover， 没办法去解释一些现象，然后你才有那种 driving force 去挑战传统你所习知的东西。我想Nakamura-san应当也是本着这个精神，他非常有好奇心，然后他去挑战 别人认为从学理上头没办法解释的东西，然后他埋头进去做。那刚好蛮幸运，我大概在一两个月前也跟大概，2010年那个 Graphite 那个石墨烯的那个诺贝尔奖的那个一个非常年轻哦，他得诺贝尔奖的时候大概 36 years 的时候，36岁。然后他碰到面的时候，我也吓一跳，这么年轻他得到诺贝尔奖，我也问同样的问题，我说你怎么会发掘这个东西？那他也给我讲说，我就是不认为这有很多物理的现象应当长那个样子，所以他就会去试。他说他用那个 tape 一直去撕，把那个石墨烯的这个东西的材料的特性给找出来。所以他们都是有这个一个特质，就刚刚讲，就是学校教你的这个物理现象，物理的东西，可能可以解释大部分的东西，但是还是有很多东西是解释不到的。就好像我上一次听那个李校长讲那个气功一样，我听完哈，那真的是肃然起敬。那校长告诉我们说哈，现在大自然的现象只有40%左右是可以用我们学到的物理来解释，还有60%的东西的现象是，一的我们不懂，我们没观察到，或是学理还没有被找到，啊，那也就代表就是说，对很多这种现象呢，应当保持这个有好奇心的心理，啊，所以在这边呢，就是我想同学这个我只能叫学弟学妹了哈，这个我们今天非常有荣幸有这个Nakamura桑来这边给我们这个讲他精辟的这个有关 LED 的这个东西，那我也把我这个有机会跟这些这个物理学家哈大师谈的这些东西呢，分享他们在这个发现以前人没有发现的这些现象的这个过程跟各位分享，也希望说这些学弟学妹们呢能够带着这个非常有启发性的这个收获哦，那回到这个学校里头去。好，谢谢各位。
谢谢苏董事长。谢谢各位贵宾的莅临，现在有请台大科学教育发展中心 Director of Center for Advancement of Science Education at 台大 Professor 高永全教授上台介绍中村教授。
Last October, the Royal Swedish Academy of Sciences announced that the Nobel Prize in Physics for 2014 was awarded to Isamu Akasaki.Hiroshi Amano and Shuji Nakamura for their invention of efficient blue light emitting diodes, which has enabled bright and energy saving wildlife sources. The press release for the prize emphasized that the invention is of greatest benefit to mankind, in full accord with the original wish of Alfred Nobel, the founder of the prize.In the several hundred Nobel Prizes given out so far, many are indeed profound and far-reaching, but not all of them are obviously of greatest benefit to mankind at first sight. Yet, everybody can immediately see the great benefit of last year's award because the light from the laureate's invention is already glowing everywhere around the world. Blue LED, together with other great inventionsalready recognized by Nobel Prizes, such as transistor, IC chip, CCD sensor, and optical fibers, have drastically changed the way we live, work, and play. While LED lamps are long-lasting and energy efficient, LED modules last 1,000 times longer than light bulbs, and 20 times more efficient for the same level of luminance. It has been said that while incandescent light bulbs lit up the 20th century, LED lamps will light up the 21st century. Professor Nakamura can be said to be the modern day Thomas Edison, who in the last century was an inspiration to aspiring students everywhere.Both Nakamura and Edison are known for their perseverance in the face of adversity. Professor Nakamura was born in 1954 in Japan. He got a bachelor's degree in electrical engineering from Tokushima University in 1977 and a master's degree in 1979. Then he joined Nichia Corporation, where he eventually made a breakthrough in producing high-quality gallium nitride crystal that enabled the realization of blue diode. He got his PhD from Tokushima University in 1994. Since year 2000, he has been a professor of materials and electrical and computer engineering at the University of California, Santa Barbara. Besides the 2014 Nobel Prize, Professor Nakamura has received many awards and honors, to name a few. He got the Benjamin Franklin Medal in 2002, was elected into the United States National Academy of Engineering in 2003. He received Finland's Millennium Technology Prize in 2006 and the Order of Culture Medal of Japan this year. Professor Nakamura holds more than 200 US patents and over 300 Japanese patents. He was inducted into the National Inventors Hall of Fame of the US Patent and Trademark Office again this year. The title of his talk today is Road Toward the New Light, the History of the Bright Blue LED, LED. Let us welcome Professor Nakamura.
Thanks so much for a nice introduction. Also, you know, so I have come to Taiwan many times, maybe 30 times. The reason is our university, UCSB, collaborating with Epistar and Everlight to develop next generation lighting. And also, I have two startup company. Also, those two startup company also some business with Taiwanese companies. So that's the reason I have come to Taiwan many, many times. And also, Taiwan now supplies supply a lot of LED chips. In the view of the number of LED chips, Taiwanese company is the top right now. So I think that's the reason why I have to come to Taiwan many times. Okay, so today I'd like to talk about this title. And so at first, always I show this complaint. Because after Nobel Prize announcement in Japan, all of the mass media and academic people and all government people's interest like this. Professor Akasaki Amano, development blue LED. My case is development manufacturing technology. Could you understand manufacturing technology? I have received a lot of awards in the past, prize, many, PlayStation award. Always the reason why I received Nobel the award is invention of blue LEDs. I never received any kind of award by development, manufacturing, never. This is the first time by Nobel Prize. Could you believe this? It's crazy, Because this one, this is, Alfred Nobel's will, Alfred Nobel's will. So Alfred Nobel say, this will, his will. So Nobel Prize should be given, this at least, the greatest benefit of mankind. This is at least. And especially for Nobel Prize in physics, this is written, one part of the part we shall have made the most important discovery or invention within the field of physics. This is real. But the Japanese academic people don't care about, Japanese academic people develop the manufacturing in my case. Never in the past. And also, this one, So this was a committee chair of Nobel Prize Physics last year, Professor Pa Shering. He commented that contribution of a three Nobel laureate, So he said, Professor Akasaki, his contribution, high quality gallium nitride growth is aluminate buffer. And Professor Amano, his contribution, demonstration of gallium nitride PN junction. And my contribution, he said, many contributions to achieve a practical level of high efficient blue LED. Committee chair said like this, But he didn't say anything manufacturing technology, only Japanese academy people, mass media and government people. I don't know why, is it crazy, no? Okay, so next I talk about LED. You know, so I talk about my contribution of how to invent blue LED. Please, you find whether I just worked for the development of the manufacturing technology or not, no? So LED is used everywhere already, you know. And so nighttime satellite image, so these regions, they use a lot of LED lighting, you know? And so this is sunlight. So for humankind, you know, most gentle lighting is the sunlight because, for human being was raised under sunlight. So we have to, the sunlight is the ultimate lighting. So long time, 18th century, people used a fire flame as a lighting source, and the 19th century incandescent bulb lamp. And the fluorescent lamp was invented by middle of 19th centuries, and nowadays LEDs. What is an LED? So LED, students. So basically, this is the basic structure of LED. So there is a substrate, and on the substrate, we have to grow N-type layer, and the next is the red layer. Red layer is we call active or emitting layer. So this emitting layer emits the blue or green emission. And finally, it's P-type layer. So in the case of blue LED, missing layer was this emitting layer and P-type layer. So basically, red layer and green layer missing in 80s. So this time, these three Nobel laureates developed this missing layer of red emitting layer and P-type layer. So that's the reason why we received Nobel Prize in physics. So this real blue LED, just substrate sapphire. On the sapphire substrate, there's an N-type layer, emitting layer, and P-type layer. And we can get blue emission. And so basically, emitting layer, by emitting layer is a real material, indium gallium nitride. By changing of the composition of indium gallium nitride, we can change the color of from UV to red colors. So we can make all kinds of colors, just changing this composition of the indium gallium nitride emitting layer using the same structure. But the biggest application is the white LEDs. So how to make white LEDs? Just a mixing of blue and yellow, or by mixing of three primary color, we can make white. But right now, most popular technology is just blue plus yellow to make, because this is much simpler. And so real white LED is like this. So blue LED, we use blue LED, also phosphor. And this phosphor changes the blue color to yellow. And the blue color directly comes from blue LED chip. And the mixing of yellow and blue, we can make white. But right now, biggest problem is this one. Right now, blue direct from blue LED chip. So it means that spectrum is very narrow and the peak intensity is so strong. So peak intensity is so strong, that causes the sleeping problem. So blue light come to the human eye, it reduces the, amount of melatonin. So, if blue irradiation causes a sleeping problem, you cannot sleep for long time blue irradiation. So right now, all of white LED emit a strong blue emission, so we cannot sleep. Especially for children. Children, enjoy the TV game using iPhone, iPad. All the backlight use this blue excited white. Blue intensity so strong. So children cannot sleep. Also lighting also emitter. So, for older people, okay. But, here you have a small kid, be careful. So later I explained, in order to solve this problem, my company started selling the violet excited white. That one is no problem. So please use a solar lamp. Okay. So these LEDs are used for the to make a bulb lamp. So this bulb lamp is used for general lighting. So this shows the efficiency of the red, blue, and green LEDs as a function of developed years. So basically, 60s, a red LED was developed. Almost four groups, four groups same time they developed the red LED. So we don't know whose group is first. So that's the reason why this time, you know, inventor of that was red LED couldn't get the Nobel Prize because almost four groups. And green and in our case, you know, in our group, we developed the first blue LEDs in 93 on the first green LEDs 95. And this white shows the white LEDs. So basically, white LEDs are efficiency is 300 lumen per watt. But this is R&D level. For mass production level is 150, half of this 300. And so 150 or 100 lumen per watt. But still, two times higher than the fluorescent lamp and 10 times higher than the incandescent bulb lamp. So impact. So basically, this is the application of the white LEDs. So initially, when we developed the first blue LED in 93, first biggest market was cell phone. At that time, not smartphone. So in 93, all of cell phone company, like Nokia, AT&T, in Japan, Docomo, they are trying to develop cell phone. But the problem is no display, which can be operated by tiny, tiny battery, 3-volt battery. So coincidentally, for my company, Nichia, started selling the blue LEDs in 93. So all you know, cell phone company came to Nichia to use the blue LEDs for the backlight of LCD. Initially blue, but later in 95, we started selling white LED. So immediately they used the white LED for backlight of LCD display. So initially biggest market is the cell phone, and then later all of the mobile devices, like iPhone, iPad, all the mobile devices use the white LED backlight. And the next is TV. LED TV, this is a projector, no? And also automobile lighting, decorative, everything, no? Also now agriculture is very interesting. All of the now, you know, like lettuce is grown inside of the clean room, no? And everything automation. So no people in the clean room, automatically everything automation. So agriculture become in the future. All average becomes in the clean room, automated, automatically controlled everything. So this is very interesting in the future. Future agriculture is very interesting. Everything, because even typhoon coming, no damage inside of the room. So, you know, so this is very interesting in the future. Okay, so LED efficiency is, so this is the efficiency of the conventional lamp and the LED, so. So this is electricity consumption in California. In California, you know, lighting consumes almost 35% among all of electricity consumption. This is a heating benefit, you know, and the DOE, Department of Energy, estimate, you know, in 2030, the 46% electricity saving by using LEDs with a current pace. So it means in 2030, this one become almost half. So it means almost 17% of the electricity is saved in 2030 in the United States. So all over the world, this one is almost five times. So in the view of the how many power plant is eliminated, almost 30 power plant is eliminated by 2030. So all over the world, you know, the five times, 150 power plant almost. So next interesting is application of solar powered LED lighting. So in these regions, basically no electricity, and so all over the world, 1.5 billion people, they don't use electricity. So it means no lighting at nighttime. So these regions, people use this one, kerosene lamp, mean basically oil lamp. And these oil lamps are very health hazard and very dangerous, it causes fire. And biggest problem is that very expensive. Now oil is very expensive, so they have to spend $150 per year to buy oil. But using LED solar cell battery, so daytime battery charged by solar cell and nighttime LED operated by charged battery. So this cost is only $3 per year. And this cost is determined by the lifetime of the battery, because LED lifetime is 50 years. Solar cell is maybe 20 or 30 years, but the battery lifetime is only 2 or 3 years. So that's the reason, $3. If battery lifetime is improved to 10 years, this one becomes $0.3, almost free. So right now, you know, automobile also uses electric car, but the biggest problem is battery. Right now, battery is the biggest problem, you know, to make this system. So we need a big innovation on battery. So next I'd like to talk about how I could invent blue LEDs. So in 80s, so blue LED research was very popular in 80s, but at that time, there are two kinds of material available, zinc selenide and gallium nitride. So zinc selenide means 2-6 material. And so in the case of zinc selenide, you know, gallium arsenide substrate are available. So in that case, crystal quality is very good. Zinc selenide, crystal quality very good, because this is really complicated. Lattice mismatch was very small. So on the other hand, gallium nitride is grown, in the case of gallium nitride, only available substrate, sapphire. So in this case, a huge number of crystal defect because the material is totally different. So zinc selenide, crystal quality is very good. So all of scientists selected zinc selenide. Gallium nitride, crystal quality is so poor, so nobody expected we can develop blue LEDs using gallium nitride. So only few people selected gallium nitride, you know. So this is a cross-sectional TM. So this, you can see dark line. This dark line is a crystal defect. We call it the dislocation. So in the case of gallium nitride on sapphire, huge number of defect. But on the other hand, zinc selenide on gallium arsenide, this magnification is a little bit different, but the same thing, nothing. Beautiful crystal, no defect. You know, so that's the reason all scientists select zinc selenide to develop blue LEDs. Because crystal is very good. This is a crappy crystal. Nobody expected this defective material using different method we can make blue LEDs. Nobody at that time. So in 89, no? So in 89, I started blue LED search in 89. So in 89, no? So zinc selenide graphite, so crystal, this dislocation density, the number of crystal defect is less than 10 to the third. And basically all of scientists selected these materials, but gallium nitride on sapphire, poor crystal quality, dislocation density is order of 10 to the ninth. So 6 orders different. You know, at that time, there's a common sense among all of the LED scientists. In order to make high-efficient LEDs and reliable LEDs, dislocation density should be less than 10 to the third. So that's the reason all of scientists say zinc selenide. 10 to the ninth, this is crazy material. So in 92, I attended in Japan, in this field, biggest conference is a Japanese Society Applied Physics Conference. So I attended this conference in 92. So gallium nitride session, you know, gallium nitride session, at first I went to gallium nitride session. So gallium nitride session is a small room is used for the session. And the session chair was Professor Akasaki, and the speaker was Professor Amano. At that time, Professor Amano was a student for Professor Akasaki. And the audience is 2 or 3, including me, you know. So that session only took less than 1 hour. Because the speaker is 1 or 2, no? And it's over. And next, I went to the zinc selenide session. Zinc selenide session is always room is this size. This size is fully occupied. And many people are standing, you know, because they cannot sleep. And, you know, and this conference continued 1 week. So zinc selenide session is every day from 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. for 1 week. Every day, more than 500 audience. Could you believe so, you know? So at that time, gallium nitride, they discussed that gallium nitride has no future, gallium people have to move to zinc selenide material. The reason is that this one. In 91, American company, 3M, you know, they developed the first zinc selenide-based blue-green laser diode. You can see, you know, zinc selenide base, you know, and this is the shortest wavelength ever generated by semiconductor laser diode. This paper appeared in 91. This paper cited all over the world. And after this paper, all of science magazine, you know, science journal says zinc selenide is a winner to develop blue LED, blue laser diode. So every has to work with zinc selenide, all of science magazine, science journal. In Japan, you know, every week, you know, there is a workshop or a conference about zinc selenide-based laser diode LEDs. You know, so that's the reason in 92, all, you know, science, you know, worked for zinc selenide. So in my case, I told you I started blue LED research 89. So before, you know, starting blue LED research 89, I went to University of Florida for 1 year, from 88 to 89, University of Florida, 1 year, to learn how to operate MOCVD. MOCVD is used for the crystal growth of gallium nitride. Because I had no background of the MOCVD, so I went to University of Florida to learn how to operate MOCVD from 80 to 89 for 1 year. And at the University of Florida, you know, I worked together with a PhD student, you know, and all of PhD students asked me, you know, oh, Nakamura-san, do you have a PhD degree? I say no, because I had only master degree. So next they asked me, have you published any scientific paper? I say no, I never published any scientific paper, zero. And then they started treating me like a technician, because in the United States, scientists, researcher means they have to have PhD degree. Without a PhD degree, everybody is called a technician. Technician is just, you know, technician doesn't need any brain. Just technician has to follow what scientists ask to order. You know, in the United States, there's a huge gap between scientists and technician. Technician's salary is like $30,000, $40,000, but the scientists, after getting PhD degree, now I'm a professor of UCSB. After getting PhD degree, they got to join the industry. Now salaries are at least $100,000 and special bonus and all. They are big difference. So they treat me like a technician. So I became so angry because my age was at that time 35 years old. 35 years, no? Students are like 20s, no? So after 1 year later, I came back to Japan. So my dream became getting a PhD degree. So at that time in Japan, we could get a PhD degree by publishing a scientific paper, at least 5 scientific papers. We can publish, you know, we didn't have to go to university to get a PhD degree. Just publishing at least 5 scientific papers, we could get a PhD degree. It's called a paper degree. Paper degree. So my main research, you know, dream became publishing at least 5 scientific papers. So at that time, I told you there are 2 materials to develop blue LED, zinc selenide and gallium nitride. Zinc selenide, a huge number of papers. You know, all over the world, many scientists work with zinc selenide. So if I select zinc selenide, I thought, oh, it's very difficult to publish papers. But the gallium nitride, basically no paper, you know. And you can select the gallium nitride, any result, any data, I can publish paper, you know, by adding a crazy theory, no? No problem, no? So that's the reason I selected gallium nitride. But I never expected I could invent blue LEDs using gallium nitride. This is a crappy material, no? Defective material. No way, no? So that's the reason I selected gallium nitride, you know? And the biggest problem, distributed density, 10 to the third. At that time, you know, this is great because at that time, and AP, Applied Physics Laser, I know famous scientists wrote a paper about this dislocated density. In order to make blue LEDs, they made a strange theory, dislocated density should be less than 10 to the third to make a blue LED. But the gallium nitride, 10 to the ninth, no? After reading that paper, almost impossible, no? So anyway, I started the blue LED research, you know, to get a PhD degree, you know? So biggest problem is that this emitting layer, indium gallium nitride, P-type gamma, so these are missing layer. N-type gamma is available already. So I have to overcome these 2 layers. So 89, I came back to University of Florida, no? And already I purchased the commercial available MOCVD. It cost $2 million. You know, so I purchased that MOCVD. At that time, MOCVD means Extron Beacon, a very famous company to make. At that time, there are no MOCVD for gallium nitride growth. I purchased the MOCVD system which is for gallium arsenide growth. So a couple of months, I tried to grow gallium nitride, but always no growth. Even if there are growth, color was black. You know, gallium nitride, the color should be transparent. So a couple of months, I worked, but no result. So and then I made a decision, I have to modify this MOCVD myself. And then I started modification, you know, of the reactor almost every day. Every morning, I modified the reactor. And every afternoon, I did crystal growth, maybe several rounds, five rounds every day. So every morning, I made a pattern. Every morning, I have to modify the reactor. Every afternoon, I did a crystal growth. You know, and I continued this pattern almost 1.5 years without any holiday. No Sunday, no Saturday. Only I could, I had a holiday, a New Year's holiday. So 3 days New Year's holiday, that's it. And 1.5 years later, I could develop this MOCVD, two-flow MOCVD. So two-flow, there's a main flow and another sub-flow, This is crazy idea, because always MOCVD, we need a laminar flow, beautiful laminar flow. If I add the additional flow vertically, it always flow dynamics people said this causes a turbulence flow. This is a crazy idea. So, but I add this one, and I was a beautiful laminar flow, and and I got the best crystal quality of gallium nitride. So this I invented this 2' CVD October 90. Before October 90, always Professor Akasaki Amano showed the best result. But after my invention of two-flow MOCVD, October 90, always our group became the best in the world, top in the world. Always from our group, we did a big breakthrough in this field. Because this reactor is best in the world, any crystal growth, crystal quality best in the world. Any device growth, highest efficient LED, any device. So October 9th, all our group became the top in this field. So since this invention, every 2 or 3 months, I could achieve the breakthrough and I could publish papers, and finally I got a PhD degree, Okay. So first, undoped gang growth. So this comes. So this one, this is called mobility, higher the better, crystal quality. So Professor Akasaki Amara, no buffer is 50, but in my case, no buffer, 200, higher the better. And using buffer layer, Professor Akasaki Amara, 450, but in my case, 600. So higher the better. So two frames is, much better, no? So next is the P-type gallium nitride growth, P-type gallium nitride, P-type gallium nitride problem. So P-type gallium nitride growth, we always have to, since 70s, people doped magnesium into gallium nitride to make P-type gallium nitride, but nobody could get P-type gallium nitride. Always the resistivity become semi-insulated, the resistivity is very high, like this one, 10 to the 6 ohm centimeter. But in 89, Professor Akasaki Amano, they irradiate electron beam for this magnesium doped gun, and they observed the P-type gallium nitride after electron beam irradiation. But they couldn't understand why they got the P-type gallium nitride by electron beam irradiation. But in our group, just we used the thermal annealing, and we added the thermal annealing, just increased temperature, we easily obtained the P-type gallium nitride using thermal annealing. And also, same time, why we could explain why we got the P-type gallium nitride? Just using thermal annealing, initially hydrogen is combined with magnesium acceptors. By using thermal annealing, hydrogen removed. And acceptor activated, and we got P-type gallium nitride. So this is called hydrogen passivation. So hydrogen passivation. So basically, in 92, we found the easy technique to make P-type gallium nitride, also clarify the physics of the mechanism of the P-type gallium nitride. So this is physics, no? Not manufacturing technology, no? Could you believe, no? This paper is our 90s, I published these papers. Japanese scientists, no? Academic people don't read these papers, no? Unbelievable, no? This hydrogen also comes from this one. Because nitrogen source, we use ammonia gas. Ammonia gas is the dissociated atomic hydrogen. So this hydrogen combined to magnesium hydrogen. So as a ground, magnesium can always include hydrogen. By using summarizing, we can remove hydrogen, and magnesium become acceptor and p-type. So in 90s, we solved all problem of p-type gas, you know? Okay. So just summarizing, we can make a p-type gas writer, you know? So next, p-type gallium, we solved all problems of p-type gallium nitride in 92. So next is emitting layer, indium gallium nitride. So basically, you know, Professor Akasaki Amano also developed this PN gallium nitride homojunction LEDs, 89, they obtained a p-type gallium nitride by electron beam irradiation, no? But this LED is gallium nitride is a band gap energy, you know, 3.4 electron volt. Even if they are emission, this is a UV emission, 360 nanometer, not blue. And also due to that, this huge number of crystal defects, basically no emission, because the sapphire substance they use, and the huge number of crystal defects, no emission. But this is also, you know, homojunction. But in order to make high efficient LEDs, people have to use double hetero structures. Double heterostructure. This idea was invented by Dr. Alfenoff and Professor Kromer. Professor Kromer is a professor of UCSB. They received a Nobel Prize in physics in 2000 because of this idea of invention of this idea. Because the reason is that using double heterostructure, the efficiency of LED become almost 100 times higher than this homojunction LED. So now LED means a double heterostructure. That's the reason they received the Nobel Prize. You know, so this is a compound of double structure. So in the case of double structure, we need an active layer, emitting layer, indium gallium nitride. So homojunction means the LED just the electron hole spread out and the recombination is small. But the double heterostructure means the electron hole are confined in the active layer or emitting layer, and then they recombine radiatively. So in this case, the efficiency 100 times higher than this one. But the problem is no indium gallium nitride. Indium gallium nitride. So in Japan in 90s, you know, this group, Professor Matsuoka group worked very hard to grow indium gallium nitride, but the crystal core is so poor. So this is their best result. So easy, you know, you can say here, you know, intensity should be higher, but the liquid nitrogen, but they are small intensity, but the room temperature are nothing, you know. These emissions come from defect, so no meaning. So they couldn't make, no high quality ingot, which indium gallium nitride, which showed the strong blue emission. But 92, no, using two frame MOCVD, we grew the high quality indium gallium nitride, which showed the strong blue and violet emission at room temperature. So this is the first report. This is a big breakthrough because this layer can be used for the emitting layer, you know. So now we could solve the indium gallium nitride problem, you know. So indium gallium nitride, we can grow high quality indium gallium nitride. So in 92, we solved the indium gallium nitride emitting layer and p-type gallium nitride. Now by stacking this sequence, we can make double heterostructure LEDs. So in 93, basically in 93, we made this double heterostructure blue LED, high efficient double blue LED for the first time. You know, but the paper appeared in 94. And the Nobel Prize press release, they copied our first in 93 high efficient blue LEDs. You know, also they said double heterostructure, the heart, this is the heart of the blue LEDs, double heterostructure, you know. Okay, this too much. And so also 95, we developed the first quantum well, blue, green, yellow LEDs, quantum, quantum wells. So now currently all of blue and green LEDs use this quantum well structure because quantum well is much more efficient. And also 96, it developed the first violet laser diode. This violet laser diode is used for the Blu-ray DVD. So this violet laser diode is used for Blu-ray DVD. Okay. This is the efficiency of the all kind of LED as a function of the dislocation density, number of crystal defects. So in 80s, you know, red LEDs were made by using gallium aluminum arsenide. So in the case of red gallium arsenide LEDs, if the dislocation density is more than 10 to the third, efficiency becomes very small. So that's the reason dislocation density should be less than 10 to the third in 80s. But in the case of gallium nitride on sapphire, you know, always dislocation density is 10 to the ninth. But here, only integral nitride. Integral nitride shows very strong high efficiency in spite of a huge number of dislocations. So only integral nitride shows a very strong emission in spite of a huge number of dislocation. So integral nitride is a miracle or magical materials, you know. So in the case of gallium nitride, if the gallium nitride is emitting layer, no emission. Only integral nitride shows a very strong emission in spite of a huge number of dislocation. This is too much, no? Okay. Okay. So next, basically three Nobel contribution is like this. Professor Akasaki Yamada developed Almira Buffer, 85, in my guess, 91 Gallium Nitride Buffer. And 89, Professor Akasaki Yamada developed P-type Gallium Nitride by using electron beam radiation. In my case, in 92, P-type were activated by samarium, and also I clarified the physics of P-type, hydrogen passivation, no? Also emitting layer in 92. So this is also another big breakthrough. So that's the reason our group could make a high efficient blue for the first time. So just a history. So October 90, I invented two-frame OCBD. So before my invention, two-frame OCBD, always Professor Akasaki Amara showed the best result. After invention of two-frame OCBD, all of breakthrough achieved from my group. Still, Nichia is a top company, no? In the field of efficiency, because they use two-frame OCBD. No, but they don't say anything about two-frame OCBD anymore, no, because due to my litigation. Okay, so this next I talk about second generation LED. Second generation is GaN on GaN LEDs. So first generation, I talked to the first generation LED. First generation is the LED grown on sapphire substrate or silicon carbide silicon substrate. It's called heteroepicyclic. Means that this is a lot of huge number of dislocation density. But second generation is a grown on gallium nitride substrate. It's a gallium GaN homoepicyclic growth. So it means basically no crystal defect. Small crystal defect, but in course, this one basically no crystal defect. So our company Solar, you know, founded in 2008. And recently, Solar published this paper, and you know, and so using GaN, we use a triangular shape chip. We make triangular shape chip. Usually, LED chip is a rectangular shape, no? But we use a triangular shape in increase the light extraction efficiency. And you can see from this paper. So this is a comprise of wall plug efficiency. Wall plug efficiency is a you know, out power and light out power divided by input electric power. So wall plug efficiency is the most important parameter. So Solar's one is wall plug 84%. This is a production, mass production, incubator mass production. But usually blue LED grown on sapphire is 50 or 60%. I asked many LED company how much the you know efficiency of blue LEDs for production. Always, all companies say 56%. You know, paper says they achieved 80 or something, but for production, always 50. This is a production level. You can say even the 85 degrees centigrade, still very high. So that is the advantage of GaN-on-GaN. The reason is that, you know, for LED grown sapphire, always again, dark line, you know, defect. But the GaN-on-GaN, nothing, beautiful crystal, you know. And the shape, the triangular shape, increase the light extension, the rectangular shape. No? And so in the case of gangwon, also we can increase the current density almost 5 or 10 times higher. So LED gangwon sapphire, already current density is very small because due to the, this droop problem. Droop efficiency becomes small, so current density is very small, less than 100 parsec centimeter. But the solar's gangwon is current density is this region, almost 5 or 10 times higher than the conventional LED gangwon sapphire. And you can see solar's LED, you know, all red, green, blue come from phosphor. So solar uses make violet LEDs using gangwon violet. So violet LED is coated by blue phosphor, green phosphor, red phosphor. So all blue, green, red come from phosphor. So that is a blue intensity is very, very small. Also, this is a spectrum, spectrum comparison. So this is a daylight, sunlight. Sunlight, full spectrum, from violet to red, all color is covered. This is ultimate light, ultimate color. And the solar's gangwon, we use violet to make white, so full color, or almost same as sunlight. So perfect light. So blue, so right now all white is made by blue, no blue LED. So in that case, blue is used except phosphor, so no violet. Also, due to the blue LED plus phosphor, this is missing, this color. Red is, I think, changing a phosphor problem. So color quality is very poor. You know, many people complain the color quality of the current white, that because they are missing color. But using solar one, no problem, all almost same as. So this is expressed by CRI. CRI is high alpha beta, you know. And another problem is white. White shirts, white paper. So white paper, white shirts always include a brightening agent to make beautiful white. This brightening agent is only excited by UV and violet, not blue. So if you use white, white LED made by blue LEDs, all white white shirts, white paper become these colors. Yellowish color, because this brightening agent is not excited. But the solar's LED use violet, so violet is emitted. So violet can excite this brightening agent, so it become real white. So this is a big, big problem, you know? Right now, these fluorescent or candace flower, so white is white. But if you go home, at home, is white LED made by blue, become yellowish, dirty color. So you have to wash it again, wash, but no change. Also, cosmetic, ladies use cosmetic. Cosmetic also is a brightening agent to make white cosmetic. You know, it's a big change, you know? You make, do cosmetic under fluorescent lamp, beautiful white, but under white LED made by blue LED, dirty color, yellowish color, no? So this is a big change, you know? So another problem is this one. So all of conventional white is made by blue LED. So this blue is come from direct from blue LED chip. Blue LED chip. So spectrum is very narrow. So to make the color white, yellow is very broad, so integrated area is very important. This is very broad, so to compute this, yellow, peak intensity should be very high because narrow spectrum to make white. So peak intensity is so strong to make white, this is Nietzsche's, but in the case of solar's one, we use violet and blue coming from the phosphor, so broad spectrum, blue. So peak intensity is much, much lower. So, so intensity very small. Only blue cause a problem of this one. Oh. Blue light disrupts the circadian cycle. Or suppress is a melatonin. Suppress melatonin means we cannot sleep. You know, because this is blue is so strong. But using a solar's lamp, blue intensity is this is incandescent lamp, so almost same as the incandescent lamp, blue intensity. So no problem, doesn't cause any problem, the sleeping problem. So please use the solar lamp, especially for kids, you know, everything. Because blue is a lot of problem right now. But this time we received a Nobel Prize by invention of blue LEDs. But after, so that's the reason now I can start talking about the problem, blue LED, you know? Before Nobel, I cannot talk about this problem. Yeah. Okay. Okay, this is, and the next, third generation LED, third. So second generation LED, GaN on GaN, and the violet LED. But the third generation lighting, so this lighting should be laser lighting. And so this shows the efficiency of LED and laser and other function, current density. So in the case of LED, which increases the current density, efficiency becomes very, very small. At this current range, almost no emission, zero. But the laser diode is, we think the current density efficiency is still very high. So laser diode, you know, current density almost 1,000 times higher than the LED, still efficiency is very high. So in order to make, for example, 60 watt incandescent equivalent lamp, LED is, in the case of LED chip, area should be this size, because the current density always should be around here, almost close to zero. In order to reduce the current density, emitting area becomes very large. In the case of laser, we can increase the current density around here, so tiny, tiny chip is okay, and to make this same brightness. You know, so it means the same size of wafer, we can make lot of laser chip. But the LED is, you know, small number of wafer. So in the build, the yield much, much higher this one. So right now, laser is 10 times higher than the LED because the process is, laser process is very complicated. But by some kind of innovation of the laser processing, we can reduce the cost dramatically. So in this case, laser become much, much cheaper. You know, now LED is, you know, you say, so LED prices go down, so no profit. But laser is still, we can reduce the cost dramatically. Some kind of process innovation. So already, still, right now, laser is very expensive, but laser is already a projector because this projector doesn't use laser, so resolution is very bad. But using laser diode, blue laser diode, this projector becomes TV, high resolution TV. It's beautiful. And it's amazing thing that proper, you know, Pico projector. So Pico projector coming soon using a laser diode. Pico projector is a small one, just connected to the iPhone. This Pico projector, 50-inch or 60-inch size is almost same as current LCD TV. It's so beautiful. So all people can have the 50 or 60-inch high resolution TV, same as the iPhone, mobile TV. So TV is totally changed soon using this blue laser diode, because the price is maybe $200-$300, so it's mobile 50 or 60 inch. I don't know what happened to the LCD company, but okay. You know, like this one is right now, laser diode is expensive, so this is a big display, but I think soon Pico project is coming. And also automobile headlamp, they use laser automobile headlamp, laser lighting for automobile headlamp, because the irradiation distance 1 kilometer using laser diode. But the LED is only 300 meter. So because the LED is very efficient, so, you know. So I'd like to thank you, all of my brother invented at Nichia, so I'd like to thank you, Nichia people, and now I moved to the United States in 2000, so thank you. So these are our center, UCSB, Solid Lighting Center. So basically, all of the devices have to use gallium nitride service in the future. And still I have time, so next is education. Yeah, my colleague asked me to talk about the education. So key for success, for key elements for success, risk taking, you know, innovation and flexibility, communication skill, team diversity, intellectual freedom, thinking hard work, infrastructure, culture support for innovation. Okay, no, sorry. So I talked about the problem of Japanese education system. But at least one thing is good for Japanese education. That is moral education is very important at the elementary school in Japan. So Japanese people are very high moral. They don't throw the trash on the road, or they pick up the trash to the garbage. That only Japanese people are doing all over the world. You know? Also, the Japanese people are very strict on time. You know, so especially for in Japan, you know, Japanese people, if we order something, some part to the company by drawing, by initially I draw the some kind of drawing, and I ask please make this part within 3 months. Japanese company can always make, you know, within 3 months. If I order 3 months, 1 month is 1 month, and that part is just you know same as the drawing. If I do same thing in the United States, and I'm a professor at the United States, I draw and please make this part within 3 months. Never happened. Never happened. Always 6 months, 7 months, 1 year later, and finally come to a total different of the drawing. You know, this is United States. You know, only in Japan it's possible. Japan. And that's the reason Japan, you know, we can make very good systems because all parts is same as drawing, on time, everything on time. So equipment is great, all equipment. That's the reason, you know, in Japan, number of novelty is relatively high because the system is perfect, all parts is perfect, you know. So that's the reason, because of moral education, you know, that is great in Japan. Quality, reliability, you know, all parts, on time delivery, you know, that's the reason. But the problem is this one, you know, Taiwan, same. Only, you know, education, most teacher wanted this one. I think Taiwan, Japan, same. Teachers is interesting, extract the best of it from students. They want to do this, but they cannot because all the parents say, oh, my son, my daughter have to go to this university, you know, top university, NTU. Japan, same. Or, you know, teacher want to do this one, they cannot. Because the parents, oh, my son and my daughter has to go to Tokyo University. Also, they have to become a doctor, medical doctor, you know, not engineering. So they have to study very hard to enter the, you know, NTU or Tokyo University. So only teaching, only this one, no? But on the other hand, United States, at the elementary school, you know, they teach coding, finance, how to, you know, use stock option, and entrepreneurship, practical skill, also routine part of the presentation. From elementary school, each student has to presentation in front of the, you know, class every week. So, you know, so this teacher is survival skill in the society. But in Japan, Taiwan, no teaching about survival skill. You know, so in Japan, you know, after enter the university, so at school it's okay, just work very hard for entering. But after entering the university, totally different. Teacher doesn't teach anything about how to solve the problem. They have to do everything themselves. They don't know how to survive. So they at the school, at the university, all the students have to play outside. They have to go to the, you know, foreign country for the traveling, those things. No, no. So, and after graduation university, they have no confidence. So, no, what's that? Energy. So they have to attend the big, join the big company, no? Because they don't know how to survive outside. So they became so conservative. They want to become, after graduation, but they want to become a government officer, or they want to join a big company. They have no idea to start a company. So study very hard. So, you know, so in Japan, no innovation, no medication, no risk then. So because they have now never learned those things, burned out. They are so tired by studying so hard to enter the Tokyo University of NTU. So tired, no power to start a company, no entrepreneurship, career development, nothing. Oh, yeah. Also, another big problem. This one, I don't know in Taiwan. Legal system is crazy in Japan. No, I don't know this one. No discovery, no process. No discovery, no deposition. Because this is most important to find the evidence. But no discovery, no deposition. I don't know you know this one. So in Japan, you know, judge make a ruling, you know, depending on how many people benefit this ruling. You know, how many people benefit by this ruling? So if the defendant is the government, always government can win. Because government means all of Japanese can benefit if government could win. So government can do anything because they have never lost in Japan. Also, if one versus is a big company, all a big company can win. Because big company, 50,000 people, many people can get benefit. But one person doesn't mean anything. So in Japan, court ruling all depends on how many people can benefit. So nobody can, one person can win in Japan. I know, actually in China, same. China ruling same. So how many people? No justice. In Japan, justice doesn't mean anything, zero. So startup company, you know, always in Japan, always big company, you know, if we start in Japan, there are several startup companies, they can do some kind of innovation, but immediately big company copy this technology. But the problem is a legal system like this, always big company can win, so startup company cannot do lawsuit. So that's the reason, another problem, there are no startup company in Japan, always, you know, big company can win, I don't know, in the Taiwan. Also, finance system, no venture capitalists in Japan. Another problem, in Japan, no venture capitalists. So when we start a company, we have to borrow money from the bank. So in that case, the bank also same time, okay, we can lend some money, but if you fail, you know, we have to take all your asset, private asset, your home, your land, everything. So if fail, we lose everything. After losing, next time we have to do suicide because we lose everything, lot of debt. But in the United States, venture capitalists, you know, take over all of the financial thing. So, you know, venture capitalists take over all financial things. So scientists doesn't, you know, lose anything. So that's a big problem. So in Japan, you know, no venture capital. So that's a problem. And this incentive to take risk and then fail. So this, no. So that's a problem. So lot of problem. So that's a no start company in Japan. So no reward without risk. So no, we cannot take a risk in Japan. I don't know Taiwan. Okay, that's it. Thank you.
好，我们谢谢中村教授精彩的演讲。 主办单位国立台湾大学准备了一份纪念品要赠送给中村教授，那我们有请杨盼池校长上台。好，接下来的 Q&A 时间将由台达光电所林公如所长与吴玉任教授主持，中村修尔教授台达电郑崇华董事长。 金源光电周明俊总经理与龙达电子苏丰正董事长参与讨论。等一下被念到名字的观众，请你站起来提问。提问前，请告诉我们您的姓名与单位，再提出您的问题。谢谢。现在我们把时间交给林所长与中村教授。Okay,
ladies and gentlemen, welcome to join the Q&A time and a very short panel discussion today, and. Gong Rulin, me and Professor Yu Renwu will serve as moderators. And we just have 30 minutes to hold for the discussion so that I try to shorten the introduction. And the first question I'd like to ask Professor Nakamura is actually just raised during his conversation with journalists. And Professor Nakamura, as you developed the first commercially available blue and green light emitting diodes and the first blue semiconductor laser, What will be the next revolution of the light industry? And can the gallium nitride laser diode play some roles in next generation lighting and especially communication or other kind of applications? Please.
Yes, I think the next big revolution is laser lighting. Laser lighting, because I told you, using a laser diode, it can revolutionize all of the display, TV, and also lighting, and also communication. Communication is laser modulation speed is fastest one. LED is nanosecond order, but laser diode picosecond order, much faster. So laser lighting revolutionizes communication, display, lighting, everything. I think the next big revolution is laser lighting.
Thank you. And also, there is a second question that is proposed to Chairman Bruce Chonghua Zheng. And as we know that Delta has diversified its business from power electronic module to automation and to green energy and to smart home. And Delta also persistently put huge budget on the research expense to deliver multi-product lines, and which is a culture very distinguished from others in the industry. So Chairman Zheng, what is the vision that makes the Delta Group emphasize so much on the R&D?
I think since we started a small business in Taiwan, only 15 people make components for TV. At that time, in 1970, there are many companies, especially like from US, from Europe, or Japan, set up a factory in Taiwan to produce TV with high volume production. And we start to make a TV set component for domestic company, and then growth, because originally it's too small, only 15 people. And then we penetrate because of a quality performance is very good. So we penetrate to make, to do business like US, in RCA, Zenith, in Europe, like Philips. And at that time, our business grew very fast. And when we start to the business with the domestic company, we spend even more than 5% of our revenue, because we will help them to design components. And the quantity is very small, like 500, 1,000, 2,000, maximum maybe 5,000. But at that time, because we put too many effort for men develop the components. And after we work together with supply to the foreign company, the quantity goes like a million pieces, or it's a very big quantity. At that time, some people asked me, are you going to spend the same amount of money for R&D? I feel if we can afford, we got to continue. I think that's the right decision, because we found like today, where is RCA? And many big company, they do not have developed too many new product for the future market. When the market becomes saturated and they decline, they disappeared. That's like a human being, they will grow and die. So it's very important to, if you can afford, you better to continue to find where is the market requirement and what kind of product you are more, have more expertise to do that, So we feel we better to still keep 5 or 6% for the new development, even that will lower our profit. Actually, if you continue that, your company can always survive. That's why. Is that explain the question?
Yes, indeed. Yeah. That is a very good theory.
Yeah.
We need to then.
Yeah.
And I guess.
Okay.
Okay.
So there's a third question from the 经济, 自由 and the Digital Lab newspaper. And the question is to the AP Star. And the reporter asked that, what's the future trend of LED industry, and especially next key application? Is that very key problem?
I think in the recent days, you know, most people are very pessimistic because of the, you know, I mean, the stock market, you know, crash worldwide, and especially the most hard hit actually is LED industry. So most of the industry or the company actually has a stock price that actually has a, you know, only 40 or 50% of their net price. So it's of the book value. So actually, it's really not a very normal, kind of situation. But we all know that the problem coming from China. So this is a reality that we have to face, especially, you know, not just the industry itself, but also the government. You know, we need to work together to find a way to fight this so-called red supply chain. Everybody called it 红色供应链. But I don't think that's the main reason, you know. I also do believe that, you know, the industry itself has to be, you know, find a way out. For industry, I let me put it, this question into perspective. First of all, in terms of the industry itself, I think it's very, very obvious, either in Taiwan or in China, the industry itself has to go through so-called shakeout. Or so-called, you know, the merger acquisition. Some company will eventually go away because they cannot survive with such a huge and tough competition. And some company with a, you know, strong base will eventually survive. So it's actually it will a big test to the, you know, to the company itself. How can you compete? How can you survive in such a big, you know, I mean, such a harsh and such a tough competition. So eventually, I think, you know, we all believe that maybe probably in Taiwan, there'll be only one or two, you know, upstream company. And in China, maybe the same thing. Worldwide, maybe there are totally maybe 5 or 6 altogether. And then it will be back to the normal, I mean, so-called oversupply situation will be eased. And so we can have a balance between, you know, supply and demand. But it will take at least 2 or 3 years, in my opinion. And on the other hand, you know, if we look at, you know, from the company itself, how can we survive or how can we, you know, be better in this tough competition? LED itself has gone to a phase that, you know, actually a lot of, you know, application has been so mature and, you know, saturated. For example, like backlight, there's almost 100% is using LED right now. And lighting is just taking off, probably around 20% worldwide, you know, penetration rate. So there's still, you know, a huge room for growth in this lighting area. But the price is always a big concern. So other than backlight and the lighting, what is the other application that LED can do? So we need to focus on some of the so-called niche market. To me, there's a so-called commodity market that is, you know, backlight and the lighting, which has a huge volume, but very low margin. On the other hand, you have this so-called niche market, which even though the market size is smaller, but it has a, you know, better or higher margin. For example, like the infrared, like the UV, automotive application, etc., and maybe bio, you know, application, you know. So that's the area we need to focus on, you know, more. And this is we so-called, you know, from the LED side. And other than the LED side, we also need to work on the non-LED side, meaning based on Nakamura-san just mentioned, this so-called core technology, MOCVD technology, is actually the core technology. It can be used to make LED, laser diode, as well as the other electronic devices. As many of you know that actually in China, they have the so-called 13 five-year plan. They'll be focusing on semiconductor-related, you know, technology. This is a huge market, and you know, everybody know, is aware of this. So for a 3-5 compound semiconductor like Epistar, we not only have to focus on LED development, we also need to work on so-called non-LED, so-called electronic devices, like power device, like microwave devices, et cetera. So this is another so-called maybe, this is another growth engine for a 3-5 company like us. So basically, just to summarize, I think, first of all, the industry itself will go through the shakeout. And secondly, we need to find out another so-called promised land for our other product other than LED.
So do you believe laser diode?
Laser diode is one of our options. Actually, that's why we work with Nakamura-san. We are working on laser diode development. So that what I mean, non-LED, including laser diode, including like electronic devices.
So the next question is to President Xu, and it's from Taipei Show, and he is asking a similar question that LED right now, there are many problems about thermal, mechanical, and optical technology in lighting. So he would like to ask you that, what's the strength of Taiwan's LED and how to compete with the, especially industry from China?
I think this is a very good question about how Taiwan will compete in this LED sectors. And I agree with Dr. George's comment, but if we look at the Taiwan's past history, especially in semiconductor, we used to have very strong DRAM, and we have a foundry. And if you compare this LED with those two semiconductor industry. Actually, LED is kind of similar to DRAM. So like Nakamura-san said, the traditional LED technology might migrate to laser. That means use a small area to produce brighter light source. The DRAM is similar. Use a small area to have a high density memory in it. So I think as time goes by, technology will getting mature and component will getting cheaper. And once it's getting mature, it means it's already in the commodity stage. And if Taiwan only do this component, it's going to face very strong challenge. And we see this happen in DRAM already. And so I think to be establish a very healthy environment for this LED industry, Taiwan's past strength is we have this chip, we have this technology, and we also have a system technology. Means we have a very strong semiconductor strength, and we have very good IT design technology. We should try to combine this component, means that just mentioned, the optics, the mechanical, the thermal, the driving technology together. Instead of just making a component, we can, for Taiwan, we should based on the past strengths to integrate all those technology together, come up with, so instead of just a lighting element, but come up with a light engine or lighting solution to provide to the industry. Try to simplify the usage of this, LED device, or add more, I call it more functionality, more friendly, means can be, we call it smart lighting, and more communication capability in this system, sub-module system. I think that's probably can give a Taiwanese company more strength, because those strengths was established in many, many years in this island. And certainly in China, they are catching up. They are setting up a semiconductor fab in the coming years, but I think with Taiwanese past experience integrated optics, mechanical, thermal, and driving electronics, I think we still have a good chance to provide a better solution to this 19 sectors. Yeah.
So I think everybody want to ask question for Professor Nakamura. Actually, I got a lot. So the first question will be from Lianhe Bao reporter, and he is asking that the Nobel Committee said that you are the Edison of the 21st century. But actually, we know that your past experience in your initial company, you are just like a Tesla. So do you think that we know that Tesla was dead and with it's not very successful in his career. But right now, of course, you already opened a company and you make a collaboration with the industry, but just like Edison. But how do you feel you are Edison, more like Edison or like Tesla?
So the reason why I moved to the United States, I mean, in Japan, no American dream, just a salaryman. You know salaryman, no? Salaryman, just work for the company like a dog. So that's the reason I went to the United States to dream American dream by doing a startup company. So right now I have two startup company. Still, I haven't achieved the American dream. So. But I'm enjoying the startup company. So that's the most important, I think. You know, you should know, because in the United States, all of rich people made the money from the startup company. All 95% or more than. So I think startup company is the most important, you know. I told you, so teaching, education, it should be focusing on how to start a company. Those things are most important in education. So that's okay. It. So
do you think that like professor that they should go to the industry to try to invest their research outcome into real product? Do you encourage you to do this, like you say?
Yes, United States all professors do start a company on the consulting, those things. So those things are most important, even for professor, student, you know,
yeah,
at the university.
Okay. So the next question is from Pan Zhenyu. His question is quite personal. He said, "Dear professor, if a senior high school student falls in love with physics, however, he cannot study physics in the future due to the environment pressure from the society, like parent expectation. So would you say something to encourage him or her that
thesis?
Yeah, physics.
Thesis. I think
physics.
Physics, no?
Physics.
Physics?
Yeah.
Fall in love with physics.
Yeah, but the parents that because social pressure help him that don't do this kind of basic research. So do you see? Can you say something to encourage? any word you want to encourage this student that if you cannot major in physics?
Major in physics? Okay. I mean, physics? I don't know that question. I don't know. So what does this answer? I don't know. I have no idea, though.
Too hard to be
answered. Yeah, it's very hard to answer, I know. It's a cultural pressure that I think a lot of students want to do research, but their parents just want them to go to some area that's making money.
Oh, okay.
So we know that you suffer a lot pressure. So do you want to say anything to this
kind
of condition?
Yeah, because I think students have to do what they like, you know. Because if you try to do that, they don't like it. It doesn't continue for a long time. So student has to select what you like, you know. You like, that's the most important, so pursue what you like. Because the problem is, I told you, in Japan and Taiwan, same. Only, you know, why you are here, NTU here, is that you are grade is great. That's the reason you are here. It doesn't depend on what you like, you know. That's a problem. You have to think about right now what you like to do. You are NTU because your grade is so good, no? Test is always 100%, so that's the reason you are here.
please ask what you want to do. You don't find what you want to do. No, that's a problem. That's Japan, Japanese and the Taiwanese education problem. So please do. You don't have to care what parents do. Parents ask you. Just you have to think of what I want to do now. So that's the most important. Yeah.
Okay. I think we still have less than 5 minutes to end this discussion, and I think it is really difficult to have so many industrial leaders and academic leaders here. So that I just want to take the time to ask our leaders: do you have any comment, or do you have any words to send to our students and young researchers in campus? Please, Dr. Su.
I used to be a college student before also, and I'm quite agree with Nakamura's comment. It's when I'm graduate from the material science, and when I choose that particular subject, actually that time I don't know what is material science, especially graduate from the high school. And as time goes by, I learn a lot and get my PhD from the U.S. I start to encourage students, before you take any decision, try to choose by your heart. Whatever you like, whatever you enjoy, stay with that. Because like I mentioned a while before, most of the Nobel Prize winner I talk to, they have a very strong passion in what they are doing. And they believe they can find something new. And during this process, it's very lonely because it's the area is no one really spend lots of time in it. But because they enjoy doing that, so that's the driving force to really encourage them to continue doing the research or doing the experiments or doing the job. So my, I don't say advice, but my suggestion to the students here is try to choose the subject you really like and hang on it and stay with it. And as time goes by, you spend more effort, you will be very successful in your area. Yeah.
Thank you. As I know that APSTAR has also a close cooperation with Professor Nakamura. So. I would also like President Zhou can answer the same question to encourage our student.
My advice will be very similar to Dr. Su. You know, I remember I graduated from National Taiwan University in the year 1982. I'm an old guy now. And I went to US in 1984, and I changed my major from chemical engineering to material scientist the first day when I arrived in US. The only reason is I don't know what is material science. And I think it has a bright future because I don't know what it is. That's why I think, you know, that's the reason why I made the decision. You know, I need to change my major because it looked like it's a brand new technology, it's a brand new, you know, which maybe there's a chance, just like, you know, Nakamura-san says. There's no risk, there's no reward. So I take the risk by changing my major, and at that time, I study MOCVD, which I didn't know what is MOCVD at all, because it has metal organic vapor, chemical vapor deposition. So it has something called chemical, and I'm a chemical engineer. So I can relate it to that. You know, that's why I choose, you know, this is maybe a good idea that I can, you know, study MOCVD. And without knowing what is MOCVD? What is the application for MOCVD? So I guess my advice will be, first of all, trust your instinct. Secondly, go for the, like I just said in my opening address, go for the area that has a bright future, that has a potential. even though you don't know what the potential will be, just go for it and try it and do the best you can do. Give it 120% of you, what you got. That's my advice to the audience here. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. And Chairman Chen, and we all know that Delta sponsored a lot of programs to encourage student academic researches and also the environmental protections in Taiwan. So would you like to say something to our students?
I always feel the science, knowledge, and the industry are progressing so rapidly, more rapidly. I think we have a lot of room to improve our education system, as well as the company, how to manage the company, use the different way or better way to do that. After I read your book, we feel more confidence to do that. And another thing I want to say, if everybody have the way of Professor Nakamura, nothing, everything were possible. Another thing is in this presentation, Professor Nakamura talk about a laser. The laser, the energy, the same input energy will create twice as much as LED. I have an idea in my mind. If we just use a blue laser as a backlight, like a TV, and you make the dot in the screen, originally we use the phosphor material to make electron heat to that material will create the blue three color. But now will be different. You all use a blue color fluorescent material, and one is nothing because you're just a blue. Another two, change the blue to red, another dot, change the red to green. So use the similar kind of concept like the past picture tube. I think the display can be much cheaper or more direct and better efficiency. That's just the primary concept I think let's think about. That's all.
Thank you, Chairman Chen. And Professor Nakamura, you are still the key to lead us to the next excellence, both in the academia and in industry. So please say some words to us to guide us. Thank you.
Okay. So I'm a professor of UCSB. So I think always my student, I always hire 10 students. Always 50% students are Asian students and 50% American and European student. And this combination is great because the Asian students are basically experimentalists. They are not so good at theory, physics. But Asian students work like a dog and always breakthrough, new finding coming from Asian students. Because they work at a lab like a dog. They're a good experiment. But European and American students are very lazy about the experiment. They are very good at reading a lot of papers, books, and they are very good for physics and theory. So after in new finding by Asian students, they come to, I can explain using this theory, something like that. So this combination works. So most important, all the discovery innovation come from the Asian student. But it happened in the United States, not happen here. Why? I think research direction is most important. If research direction is wrong, even work though, no innovation, no discovery. So research direction, I think here in Asia, the lack of the research direction is a problem. So students are very good, no problem. So I think, you know, if Asian students go to the United States, they can become a Nobel laureate easily, you know? So I think here, research direction is something wrong, I think. So that is the most important thing, I think.
I think that seems to be a very wonderful note, bring us to the end of our panel discussion. And I'm so sorry that due to the time limitation of our panel discussion, we still have too many questions not to be answered. But I would like to ask you to give a round of applause to all the panelists and yourself. And I'd like to thank you for your joining with us today. Thank you.